Hello, I'm Henry Mack, and welcome to this week's Issues. Miami's beaches, nightlife, and culture continue to bring tens of thousands of new residents to the Magic City. But what should residents, both old and new, know about the local real estate market? Is it time to buy, rent, sell, whatever? And how does the threat of sea level rise play a role? The Miami Herald partnered with local pollsters Ben Dixon and Amandi International to get the lowdown from local industry insiders. And so we'll break down the survey with results from the firm's Anthony Williams later on. But first, we've come a long way from the start of the presidential race, and it's now finally down to two, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. And no doubt, a historic milestone for women, but as of this taping, Senator Bernie Sanders is still fighting the good fight and has not withdrawn from the race. And so joining me to analyze, we welcome Maurice Ferrè, former mayor of the city of Miami and former chair and vice chair and current board member of the Miami-Dade Expressway Authority, or MDX, Juan-Carlos Planas, partner at the law office of Kaplan, Young, Moll, and Parron, and former Florida State Representative Kathryn DePalo, senior instructor in the Department of Politics and International Relations at Florida International University. Thank you all for taking the time.
Thank you.
JC, I'm going to pick on you first. You're wearing your GOP cufflinks, nice big, you know, elephant cufflinks there, but yet on, you know, through the grapevine, I've heard you're voting for Gary Johnson.
Well, I was about to say that the race is down to three.
Okay.
Not two.
Help us square that. Explain that and your feelings towards, I think, maybe the GOP nominee.
First of all, I was a Jeb Bush supporter in the primaries. I was very fortunate to be a member of the legislature when Jeb was governor, and I felt that what he did for the state was extremely important to the state's growth, and I thought that he could do the same for the country. Unfortunately, the electorate in the primaries felt different. I do not believe that Donald Trump is prepared to be president of the United States.
Why not? And,
I'm sorry?
Why not?
Because I don't believe he has the right temperament. I think this week showed it more than anything. I think too much has been focused on the fact that he brought ethnicity into his criticism of the judge, and not enough has been focused on the fact that we have a candidate for president who has not yet divested himself of his businesses and is attacking a federal judge in a lawsuit. The founding fathers placed separation of powers in the Constitution for a reason. The executive should never be in a position to try to intimidate the judicial branch. And yet we have somebody who's running to be the chief executive officer of the United States, and he is publicly making comments about the alleged partiality of a member of the judiciary who was appointed by both parties. This is completely and utterly unacceptable.
Yeah, Kathryn, to the poli-sci professor at the table and sort of the neutral party here, an exciting time really to teach politics at FIU, and I'm wondering sort of what your take is on the whole race.
Well, it's interesting because everybody seems to be talking about this race. I mean, most people pay attention to presidential elections, but this year seems to be pivotal. Everybody seems to have an opinion one way or another, whether it was the primary on the Democratic side and the Republican side. And now we're at a point where party members are coming together. Or not, as we see on the Republican side, you know, are some of these voters now going to vote for the Libertarian candidate? Are they maybe going to even vote for Hillary? Are they strongly going to get behind Trump? And on the other side, a lot of these, the Bernie Sanders voters, we're not sure yet. It's still too new. Sanders is still technically running, but we'll know in the next few weeks where those voters are going to head. But, you know, you see these national polls and in some of these key battleground states, and it's a neck-and-neck race. So we've still got a long way to go to figure out where this is going to turn out.
Sure. Maurice, stalwart, really, of Democratic progressive principles here in Miami-Dade County, and Hillary supporter. Are you happy with your party's nominee?
I think Hillary is one of the best prepared human beings to be president. The issue is not whether her knowledge is good. The issue really is her judgment sufficiently good to do the job. And there I have some doubts, but the bottom line is I think she's significantly better than Trump.
The skepticism about the judgment, what are you basing that on?
Well, I think that she, like Bill, her husband, the former president, triangulate in the parlance of the Clintons too much, which means that they they try to figure ways of taking your position, taking the edges off of it, and then making it my position, and therefore you can't go against it, we pass. But, you know, in defense of that, that's how we ended up getting a balanced budget, and we got a lot of other things that were progressive during the time of Bill Clinton. The issue for me is that we're not in the 1990s anymore. We're now in 2016, and this is a different America, and it's a different world. It's certainly a different Republican Party, and I think it's a different Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. Now, I voted for Bernie Sanders in the primary, and I voted for Bernie Sanders because I know he didn't have a chance to win Florida, and he was going to get a very low vote, but I thought it was important to send a message. And I think I wanted, and I still want Hillary to really have to fight for the nomination, because I think that'll prepare her better, not only for the 150 days left until mm-hmm. the election, because that's what we have left, but also as president. And I think it's highly unlikely that she will, unless there's a thunderbolt like the FBI or something like that. I think it is most probable that she'll be the next president of the United States.
Most probable that she'll be the next president. JC, do you agree with that?
Unfortunately, yes. I think part of the problem that Donald Trump has, forget about the fact that he has these verbal gaffes, that he says things that are an abomination to people. Trump has ignored metrics in this campaign more than any other Republican candidate. He has ignored organization. He has ignored the fundraising aspect. Even if most people say that Trump probably only has $200 million liquid that he can put in. He's not going to put that into his race. But even if he did, it's a drop in the bucket compared to what the Democrats are going to have. Now, Donald Trump, unlike other campaigns that I've been involved in, and I've been involved in almost every single Republican campaign since I've been 18 years old. There are field workers on the ground, there are phone bankers, there are people out there walking door to door. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump has none of that, nor does he have money to build that infrastructure. If you look at the primaries, every single primary that Donald Trump lost, it was because metrics mattered and he got outworked. There was more organization by either Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio or one of the other candidates. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump has invested nothing in this organization. The Democrats are organized. There's no way that Donald Trump's going to be able to catch up to that type of organization. Yeah, I think that's a problem.
Do you think it comes down to just organizational infrastructure? And as of this taping, I think Clinton just hired Sanders' top student organizer to sort of garner this grassroots support. And so does it come down to just who's got the better ground game?
I think the ground game is certainly important, but again, I mean, we're just seeing how this race is going to shape up. What I find interesting is the political class and the Republican political class really do not like Trump. But if you talk to regular voters, they are all for him. And some people, I think, aren't as vocal because they don't agree with some of his comments that he's made, you know, about women and abortion or this the federal judge this week. But they want a businessman. You know, they want somebody who's going to tell it like it is, no yeah. matter what that is. So I think it's going to be interesting when we start to see how voters are going to pan out. And I always say that the people who show up at the polls are the angry voters. Who's angry right now? So I have no idea how this is going to come down.
Yeah, everyone's angry.
Yeah.
Well, I think the angry voters are really the primary voters. I think the general election voters are, it's a little bit of a different cut. And as to Trump's approach to things, remember there was a time where 80% of the Republican base rejected Trump. And then that started to change. Now it's up to 68% or 70% or whatever it is currently that accept Trump as the Republican nominee. So the Republican base has also changed in this position. But look, I think we have to step back. Look at how the U.S. elects its presidents. It's in the Electoral College. Now, I think 100% or 99% of people who analyze presidential politics will accept that today, 40 states are basically set. You're not going to change New York, California, or Texas, for example. So the election is then decided in 10 states. Now, at one time, it was five or six states, but that's changed. Now, for a Republican with the demography of the United States in 2016, to become president of the United States, the Republican tent has to be broadened. And that's what Jeb Bush wanted to do. And that means bringing in Hispanics. Where are the Hispanics that count? Not in New York. If not one single Puerto Rican votes in the state of New York, it's still going to be Democratic. So that's not the issue. It's where the Hispanic vote makes a difference.
Virginia, which is
Florida, number one. Mm-hmm. Nevada, Colorado, New Mexico, Virginia, Ohio. Now, you say, well, Ohio, yeah, well, 4 or 5%. But when you get an election that's that close. So here's the point. For you to understand Trump, you really have to bring in here Roger Stone and talk to Roger Stone, because what Trump is doing is not following the usual way of getting elected president. He has a new way, and the new way is to get the white vote, which in the last election, 2012, voted 58% Republican. Mm-hmm. Now, the polls show us that that's up to 60%. Now, if in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, Iowa, those five states, he can get that up to 62%, then Trump can be the president of the United States.
The problem
with
that
is so fascinating. Neither in recent history, or if at all, each party candidate only has a chance because of the other. So
precisely.
Yeah. Neither have a chance if it weren't for the other, which is so paradoxical.
Absolutely.
In all of this. But JC,
completely.
So please respond to Maurice's analysis.
I think part of the
analysis.
Problem that Trump has with the strategy, and Maurice makes a very valid point, mm-hmm. the problem is how far do you go to try to tear out the white vote in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Ohio that doesn't cause you to lose Florida, Virginia, and Colorado, where the Hispanic vote has shown to be the swing vote.
Well, you don't need Florida, Virginia, and Colorado if you get Michigan, Ohio,
Pennsylvania,
right.
And Iowa, and Ohio. But again, that's risky. Pennsylvania has not gone for a Republican since 1988, and George H.W. Bush. Wisconsin has not gone for a Republican
since
88.
But for example, Ohio today, this morning, is 44%. Michigan is a tie. So in other words,
same with Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania is the one that came out today was at 44-44. Yeah. So the point is,
and that's
if Pennsylvania
Trump,
is 44-44,
of anti-free trade. There are people in Ohio and Pennsylvania where the anti-free trade argument that Trump makes is going to resonate. I still think, remember in 2000 it was Florida. I do think it's Virginia. I do not see a pathway forward to a Republican winning the presidency without winning Virginia. And again, I think that's a very changing state.
Do you think the Trump organization is this analytical with respect to
how
to win?
And that's their biggest problem.
And I say absolutely, along with Roger Stone, who was behind the scene, obviously, because
the Prince of Darkness,
because he broke officially with Trump. Don't believe it. There is the poster that comes with is now on board. And by the way, that poster was also Rick Scott's poster.
Yeah. Stone didn't break with Trump. He broke with Corey Lewandowski.
Yeah.
He still advises Trump behind the scenes. But again, there's many people who believe that Roger Stone is a character of a bygone era. I do think that
certainly.
Type of politics doesn't work anymore. I think Trump thinks he can win with it.
We'll certainly know soon because the poster that is part of all of this certainly has a record of calling him right.
Yeah. And nobody predicted Rick Scott would win.
Can we pivot locally in what this national race may have? To what extent this may impact local races? The local, I don't know, GOP race for Senate, representative, mayoral, commissioners.
We do see more races in legislative seats than we have seen before. Normally, the battles have been in primaries. I think we're going to see some very tough battles in some state Senate districts and partisan races in November, as well as a couple of House seats. Annie Terry Flores normally has gone unopposed in a general election. Now she has a tough election, although I think she'll pull it off. Congressional elections, I think, are going to be very important. As far as the state House, I think there's only one or two. I think it's the state Senate where it's important. And of course, as my friend the mayor was saying earlier, I do think the mayor's race, If it does not get decided in August, I think if it goes to November, that dynamic is very different.
Kathryn, is that true that the national ticket and debate has this extent, the effect of influencing local races like this?
I mean, a lot of times local races are based on local issues. I mean, even some House districts are very particular to what is going on. And in a state like Florida, you know, what is happening in Miami is going to be very different from what's happening in Jacksonville or Orlando or Tampa. And I think on the Republican side, you're going to have candidates who are going to be running from Trump when it is expedient to do so, particularly here in South Florida, and running their own local races on local issues, what they want to do.
Right.
See, everybody says that it's the I-4 corridor. Well, the I-4 corridor voted Republican the last two times. Last time it wasn't by much, but if you take the I-4 corridor, it voted Republican. So how did Barack Obama win in 2008 and 2012? Well, in South Florida. So how does Hillary Clinton win? Well, in South Florida. How many votes does Hillary Clinton need to carry from South Florida? I define that as Palm Beach South.
Sure.
500,000. That means that she has to have the Democrats carried Miami-Dade County by 200,000 votes in the last presidential election. We need to do 250. That affects the local races. Why? Because I think there's going to be tie-ups. In other words, I think you're going to see Hillary Clinton campaigning with some of these local candidates. Now, some of these races are very tight. For example, Miguel Diaz de la Portilla and Jose Javier Rodriguez, that's a tight race. Yeah. So what's happening? The Democratic Party in Washington, in Tallahassee, and locally are putting in money, effort. The field operation is amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, amazing. They have hundreds of people out on the street canvassing.
It's going to be interesting to see.
And it's going to be affected.
We have to call it a day. But
thank you.
Thanks for taking the time.